Hello and welcome to this Friday edition of Catholic Answers Live, and it's a very, very good Friday edition. We've got two great authors and men of faith here with us for both hours today. Second hour, Dr. John Cutterback from Christendom College will be here, and we're going to talk about living a good life. That's really what Dr. Cutterback has devoted himself to, is helping young people in particular, as a professor at Christendom College, but all of us, to think about living a good life, living the life that God intends for us, and we will do that as we wrap up the week. I think today is probably a great day for talking about living in peace, and that's what we're going to do in the first hour. Maybe you found your peace disturbed in recent days, weeks, months, years, decades. Maybe you've given up on finding peace. Would you like some help in finding peace? Maybe you'd like to talk to a priest about all of this. That's what our show this hour offers, and you are welcome to call 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Our guest literally wrote the book on peace. It's called Living in Peace, and he's got a new book coming out this spring from our own Catholic Answers Press called Real Religion. In addition to being a prolific writer, he's also a missionary of mercy and the pastor of Our Lady of Grace Parish in Indian Land, South Carolina, Father Jeffrey Kirby. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you. Appreciate being on the show.
Any of your parishioners experiencing any disturbances of their peace or in recent years, or is everything perfectly peaceful in South Carolina?
No, I think my parishioners, I have about 1,000 families in my parish, and I think that my parishioners are experiencing what we see across our country with this pandemic, and in particular some of the continuing side effects of the lockdown, some months ago. So you can take your pick in terms of, marital problems in the extreme, domestic violence, child abuse, depression, regression to alcoholism and drug addiction or abuse of prescription drugs. Just the list goes on. It is a challenging time for everyone. In fact, I've shared with my parish from the pulpit that I have experienced more pastoral issues, emergency, urgent pastoral situations in the last 8 to 9 months than I have in the last almost 14 years of my priesthood.
Wow, that's extraordinary. That's an extraordinary statement and a disturbing one. But you haven't given up on peace at all. You're committed to the idea that it is in fact possible to have peace in this life.
Absolutely. And I'm so grateful, Si, that you asked the first question first, because I don't want anybody to think that this is some type of Pollyannaism or misplaced positivism or optimism. No, we live in a fallen world, and there's real hardship. But as Christians, we know that our peace comes from above. It's a divine gift. The fact that we claim and continue to labor and fight for peace is real. We roll up our sleeves. We're in the trenches. We are knocked down and hurt just as anyone else. But as Christians, we know that there's a gift given to us that nothing in this world can take from us. And that's the gift of peace.
So, nothing in this world can take from us. And, Jesus says about peace, I give not as the world gives. We understand that peace to be conferred on us somewhere. So where do we go? give me that.
exactly. So first, and the Lord distinguishes both, but I've come to give you peace, but then yet I do not give you a peace of this world. That distinction is so important, because by peace, we do not mean that everything is always going to go the way we want.
Yeah.
Things will always go smoothly, or there'll always be feelings of euphoria. And so on. No, it's a fallen world. In fact, we know that if we're going to accept the gift of peace, we know in a fallen world that will involve suffering. The peace that the Lord gives, we know, is a divine gift. And how do we get that? Or how do we hold on to it? Because we can surrender it. We can allow things to eclipse or take it from us. But, we give that permission of itself. That peace cannot be taken, again, unless we surrender it. So how do we strengthen ourselves? Well, if it's a divine gift, then the task is to draw closer to God. He's the one who bestows the gift, we draw closer to him. So principally through the sacraments, but also through prayer, the study of the scriptures, through selfless service in Christ's name, through holy fellowship with other believers, by sharing the sorrows and the woes, you know, of this age. I love in the funeral mass, we even pray. We say that, you know, as sorrow weighs heavy on the heart, and then we go on to remind ourselves of the truths of faith, because those sorrows, I mean, they weigh heavy on the heart.
Yeah.
And yet, through the midst of that, we know this gift is a divine gift, and if we want to hold on to it, persevere in it, strengthen it, then we do the things of God. So if someone says, I feel like I'm losing my peace, I feel like, you know, I can't hold on to this. So, well, when was the last time you made a good confession?
Ah, yeah.
Or when was the last time you really tried to just open up your heart and speak spontaneously from your heart? You know, so the psalmist says, from the depths of one's heart, right? You know, and so on. So if we want the gift of God, we have to draw close to God.
Our number is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Our guest is a pastor, an author, and also a papal missionary of mercy, Father Jeffrey Kirby. If you have questions about the Christian understanding of peace, if you have some, if you are in fact seeking that and struggling in that area, this hour is for you. 888-318-7884. I'll tell you something, Father. Since about the election, I was very concerned about the election, as every single person in America was. I think people all around the world were. After it was over, and then it wasn't over, and I know all that, I pretty much quit watching any television, because and even listening to radio shows that I usually listen to, because it was disturbing my peace. And now this is what I want to ask you. Am I somehow being irresponsible to do that, or are there times where it's just like, I gotta get away from this?
Yes, I'm glad you asked that question. In fact, we see even in the life of our Lord during his public ministry, there were times where he would remove himself from the crowds. Like we hear in various accounts that even the crowd pushes towards him, or they continue to make requests of him, and yet, you know, the Lord absents himself in order to go and to pray, to be in solitude with God the Father. So I see in that we can glean a truth that, you know, while there are times when we have to stay in the fight, if it, you know, duties pertaining to our vocation or responsibilities that we have that are a part of our employment or a profession that we're a part of, in that case, then we have to continue to stay in the fight. But beyond that, there are times in which, you know, for, you know, the sake of our own peace, for that desire for greater virtue, we have to remove ourselves. Because I think if anyone just sat and watched the news, you know, yeah, all the time throughout the waking day, like, I think they would just be so distressed and so anxious and so, you know.
Yeah.
And I want to just clarify that while peace is a divine gift and nothing can take it from us, we can surrender it.
You know what I mean? Right. You know? Right.
So I stress that because I want everyone who's hearing this to know there is no power on this earth that can take the peace that God has given to us. I mean, Maximilian Kolbe, we celebrate his birthday today. Like, he was in Auschwitz, and he did not lose his peace. I cannot imagine a more horrific place on the face of this planet, and yet he was there, and he did not lose his peace. Or Edith Stein, by also in Auschwitz, and we can go on. So nothing can take it, but we can surrender it. You know what I mean? So,
yes,
so I think for our sake,
I feel like I have many times, actually, you know, surrendered it. And maybe that's one of the skills of life, is learning not to, you know, keep going back to those things that, even if it's just watching the evening news, where take an evening off. You don't need it all the time. Father Jeff Kirby is our guest. As I said, he's a papal missionary of mercy. If you need some mercy, he's here to help. He's also the pastor of Our Lady of Grace Parish in Indian Land, South Carolina. But he wrote the book, Living in Peace, and that's what we're talking about today. 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. I wish I could tell you can pre-order it, but you can't. We're not quite there where we're taking pre-orders for it. But in March, it'll be out. Real Religion, the new book from Father Jeff Kirby at Catholic Answers Press. We got to take a quick break. You go ahead and dial that phone. You need some help with peace in the family. You're having trouble with your own personal peace. You'd like some help. 888-318-7884.
Catch Catholic Answers Live anytime at Catholic.com. Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite Monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Wings is the weekly newsletter that's packed with program info, features, and updates of all that's going on at the Global Catholic Network. Just go to ewtn.com/wings, fill out your name and email address, and you'll start getting your wings every week. When you get yours, send it to all your friends, and they can send it to their friends. And pretty soon, we're covering the whole world with the good news about EWTN. Wings, the weekly newsletter from EWTN, the Global Catholic Network.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's pretty hard to beat this for a Friday lineup. Second hour, philosopher John Cutaback will be here with us, and we'll talk about living the good life. What does it mean to live the good life? I mean, life doesn't seem so good for lots of people right now. A perfect time to talk about getting back to basics on that. But another of the basics of Christian life, as a matter of fact, Christ preaches about peace all the time, invokes peace on others, blesses those who are peacemakers themselves and all of that. One of the fundamentals of Christian life is peace, and it is something that seems so disturbed in many Christian people right now. And it's heartbreaking because it's the great gift that Christ wants to bestow on us, and sometimes we just let it slip from our hands because things are difficult or because our culture is a mess. Those are my words, not Father's. I don't want to put words in his mouth, but if he doesn't notice that our culture is a mess, we need a new guest this hour, Father Jeffrey Kirby. Father Jeffrey Kirby is our guest. Father, I would say probably, a person with three adult children, I feel like one of the ways that you can possibly have experience constant assaults on your peace is to have children. I mean, that you're it's not just about me, you know, and about what I have, but, you know, once they're babies for the rest of your life, you're worried about, do they have what they need? Do they know God loves them? Are they going to forget? Are they going to fall? You know, all that. What do you say to parents struggling with kids who it's hard to have peace when you got kids?
Yes, I say that to parents, stay the course, hold the line. Oftentimes there's particular tension or struggles for peace when, you know, particularly with teenagers where they're challenging or pushing boundaries or, you know, and I realize for a lot of parents, you know, it could be easier to think to just look the other way. Or to just, you know, reduce standards or to not allow or to continue to fight for the formation of virtue in their children. And I would say to them to stay the course. But broad picture, any parent, whether it's with little ones or with teenagers and so on, is, you know, to draw close to God. I am so edified when I see parents bring their entire families to confession, you know, whether it's once a month or whether it's, you know, quarterly or however they're able to do it. But, you know, to really bring the whole family in order to receive, you know, the grace of the sacrament or to see a family, you know, together at Mass. I know sometimes that with schedules, things have to be split up, but it's so important for families to be together, especially at worship. I also encourage parents, like, as you're able, like, I know that there are sports and there's, you know, other interests and there's musical, you know, things and there's all the other things that children are involved in and that can stretch the family in different directions. But I say, you know, the power of the family meal, having dinner together, you know, even if it's not every day, like just a couple times a week where everyone in the family knows it's sacrosanct, like Thursdays we eat together no matter what. That means, well, you're not going to practice tonight, you know, or you're not going for your yeah. Piano practice, like family first. Like that time is so important because that relationship with, you know, with the members of the family, especially parents to children, is so essential, you know, in terms of preserving and holding that peace.
888-318-7884, our number. You are welcome to call if you have challenges to your own peace and would like to. And let me tell you, too, you're always welcome, even if you're not Catholic or Christian, if you would like to have some understanding about why we call Christ the Prince of Peace and why we say that he bestows a peace upon us that the world cannot understand. 888-318-7884. Father Maria in Kansas wasn't able to stay on the line, but asked this: is there a possible list of resources or exercises for prayer to ask for peace? I have the desire, but I don't know how when there is so much chaos around me. What might you say to Maria?
Yes, I say, you know, in terms of the chaos or you know, the twists and turns of life in a fallen world, and or because of our own simple nature, all the above, I'm always encouraged in the scriptures that before the Lord is referred to as the Prince of Peace, he's also addressed as the Mighty Warrior. And I have to imagine that the prophet put Mighty Warrior before Prince of Peace because, almost like letting us know, God is a mighty warrior. Like, he can fight this. He's got this, right? So he is the Mighty Warrior and the Prince of Peace. And I think whatever chaos or struggles we have, we know that we worship a God who's not simply Prince of Peace, but is the Mighty Warrior that helps us to have that peace and to hold that peace that he offers. With that said, in terms of Maria's specific question, and an easy devotion that is known throughout the church that is very easy to pick up if she's not already praying it, I would strongly recommend the Divine Mercy Chaplet. I have found that to be a source of incredible peace, especially when there's a quick, you know, flash of struggle or difficulty or shocking news, to just pick up my rosary and pray my chaplet on the rosary. I found that to be incredibly helpful. Also, I would recommend the Stations of the Cross. Ideally, to go to your parish church and actually walk the stations. I know in some places that's not possible, in which case you pray it at home. But actually, even if you pray at the stations at home, like if you can walk, even if you're just walking around your living room, right? Because what I love about the stations with that is it engages our whole body. Like we're literally on the way, the Stations of the Cross, the Way of the Cross. And I have found just that reflection on the different stations of our Lord's Passion to give me incredible peace, because this is a God who knew suffering and conquered suffering and sorrow from the inside out. And those two devotions I'd recommend, they're popularly known, Divine Mercy Chaplet or Stations of the Cross, but to maybe put that perspective of doing those in order to preserve peace, I would strongly recommend those.
888-318-7884, our number. We're talking about peace. We're talking about the peace, gaining that peace that won't go away in your life. It is not a time of peace in our culture. It's anything but a time of peace in our culture. So we invited Father Jeffrey Kirby to come and talk with us about peace. He wrote a book called Living in Peace, and he's got a new one called Real Religion coming out this spring from Catholic Answers Press. Again, 888-318-7884. Let's go to anonymous caller in Winthrop Harbor, Illinois. Anonymous caller. Can I go to the anonymous caller? I'll tell you what, I'll come right back. We just have a little cross up on the phones. Because I did want to ask you this, Father, I will ask it now instead of waiting till after this caller. It's hard to have peace when you live in an atmosphere of injustice, and many people are feeling, rightly or wrongly, that they themselves are experiencing tremendous injustice right now. Sometimes they'll say it like, you know, my pastor closed the church and won't let us go to Mass, and that's an injustice, or the government has shut things down. But even if they're not saying that it's personal injustice towards them, many people are very upset about, you know, the gross injustices of our time against immigrants. There's racial injustice, and there's the massive injustice of widespread resort to abortion. So I think this is what disturbs people's peace very much now, is this sense of being offended at injustices done against me, maybe, but also very upset at the general acceptance of injustice in our world.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, in fact, whenever, you know, myself, when I'm reflecting on that or you know, allowing myself spiritually to be aware of that injustice, or people, you know, ask questions, you know, how do I find that peace, as you're describing, in the midst of, you know, this injustice? You know, I always go back to the end of the Lord's Prayer. You know, with the Lord's, you know, of course, we pray to be preserved from temptation, but also to be delivered from evil. And that second part of that petition, so protect ourselves personally from temptation, but then also protect us from, you know, the evil of the world, or some translations would read the evil one, you know, the prince of the fallen world. But I go to that last part of the Lord's Prayer because even as the Lord was teaching us to pray, he was acknowledging, like, there's a lot of bad stuff out there.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah,
like,
right.
There's a lot of dark stuff, and there's a lot, I mean, you know, he's teaching this prayer to the original listeners who are literally occupied by a foreign Gentile power. And he's acknowledging that in our day, the Lord is acknowledging that, and he's teaching us, you know, the principal way is through prayer. I think it's powerful that Mother Church in the liturgy runs with that petition and adds the additional prayer, you know, deliver us from every evil and allow us to persevere. Give us this joy as we wait in joyful, as we wait for the coming of the Lord, for that blessed hope of his return. So I think that in terms of a spiritual response, it's prayer, the realization that the trials of this world, you know, our pious tradition says that the valley of tears, that as this, you know, continues and as we walk through it, this leads us, it's the proving ground in order to prepare us for eternal beatitude. And I think that hope of heaven cannot be underestimated nor forgotten. I think that, you know, with that hope, it allows us to realize this evil or this injustice or these struggles, however long standing they might be, or however, you know, temporally in this world I am powerless to overcome them, spiritually in terms of the power of our soul and that gift of peace, you know, these injustices do not win, right? I think it's very powerful. I can go back to the example of Father Maximilian Kolbe, who I have a very strong devotion to. You know, he never saw the victory of his acts of charity in this world.
Right.
You know, it was only an eternal life that he saw and knew, right? And we, the believers, we rejoice because we get to see a glimpse of that victory. So I think when we feel like we are yoked by injustice and we feel powerless in this world to overcome them, we cannot believe or falsely acknowledge or think that we don't have any power, because actually we have the greatest of powers, you know, like,
yeah.
Because we have the spiritual power. St. Paul reminds us in Ephesians, like, we don't battle the things of this world. We battle the supernatural, you know, the powers and dominions of the dark world and the fallenness around us. So I think that, you know, nurturing and fueling that sense of hope, that theological, powerful virtue of hope in eternal life by praying and by acknowledging, as evil as this is, and however the reality might be, that I might never see it overthrown in this life, in my life.
Yeah.
I know that this evil or this injustice does not win.
We can go to Anonymous now in Winthrop Harbor, Illinois. Anonymous, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Father Jeffrey Kirby.
Father Jeffrey, good evening.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead with your question.
Okay. My question is, how can you find peace, or how can I find peace if I try all my life, and I'm not going to lie, I've tried all my life to be a good woman, to be a good daughter, to be a good sister, to be a good person in general, to be a good worker, to be a good Catholic. I've tried with all my heart. When I compare myself to others, I see myself, maybe I shouldn't have, but I've done it. When I compare myself to others, I see myself trying even harder than other people, trying to be a better person every day. But when I see my life, when I see my family life, and when I said my family life from my parents to my grandchildren, all our lives are falling apart.
Addictions, divorces,
right. Resentments, even situations illnesses. How can I find peace in situations like this?
All right, thank you.
So that's a great question. And if I can maybe start with clarifying just a little bit in terms of when we speak of peace, in the full biblical sense. We can summarize it as the tranquility of order, which means in our life we try to have a right relationship with God, a right relationship with our neighbor, with ourselves, with creation. And that you've described your efforts throughout your life to have that peace. Now, just because we have that peace doesn't mean that everything in our life or the life of our loved ones will go smoothly. In fact, oftentimes they will not.
Father, we got to conclude this answer on the other side. Anonymous, please hold on. I'd love you to get Father's full answer. We're talking about finding peace with Father Jeffrey Kirby. We'll continue that right after this break on Catholic Answers Live.
We're waiting for your call. Grab that line and get on board.
To many people, even many Christians, purgatory is a fantasy, or worse, a wicked lie invented by the church to make salvation complicated and keep people in fear. But I'm here to tell you that purgatory is fact, not fiction. The Bible supports it, Christians have historically believed in it, and it makes theological sense. In my new book, Purgatory is for Real, I provide the evidence and reasoning to help you understand this controversial doctrine and demonstrate how it's actually a joyful, hopeful reality, not something shadowy and mysterious, but a sign of God's love and mercy. To get your copy of Purgatory is for Real, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Bishop Joseph Strickland of Tyler, Texas, is one of the most courageous leaders in the church, known for his outspoken support of unborn life, Orthodox faith and morals, and reforming Catholic institutions. In his groundbreaking new book, Light and Leaven, he offers a forthright perspective on the state of the church today and calls on the lay faithful to meet its challenges boldly, touching on topics including parish renewal, the centrality of the Eucharist, the need for prayer and silence in a noisy and distracted age, and the battle between good and evil in the church and world. Bishop Strickland's wise insights and evident love for souls will inspire and edify you. To order your copy of Light and Leaven, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Our guest this hour is Father Jeffrey Kirby, who wrote the book Living in Peace, and he's got a brand new book called Real Religion coming out here at Catholic Answers Press. And we're talking about peace. We're talking about living in peace, and if you'd like some help in that regard, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. We have an anonymous caller on the line talking about how she's struggled all her life to do what the church teaches to do, to live in friendship with God and do all of that. And now she's a grandmother and she finds with her own children and grandchildren all kinds of troubles and struggles and addictions and problems, and does not feel that that all of that that she's worked for in her life has brought about peace. Father, I'm so sorry we had to interrupt you in the midst of your answer, but go ahead and continue with what you were saying to Anonymous.
Yes, I was summarizing the first part, just that, you know, from the scriptures we could summarize peace as the tranquility of order and different relationships we have in life. So with God, our neighbor, ourselves, creation. And oftentimes when we have the gift of peace and we're doing the right things, that does not necessarily mean that everything then in our lives, the lives of our loved ones, will go smoothly. So, you know, I can understand the person who says, well, if I do all this stuff and I have peace, then that means that it should flow throughout the lives of my family members and children and grandchildren, and they should have peace. And I wish it worked like that for all of us. but oftentimes what I have found pastorally is that the person who has preserved peace, God will allow them to be placed. So we know St. Paul tells us in Ephesians that every family receives its name from the heavens, that God will allow that person to be placed precisely in families with chaos and difficulty, so that they can be the witness to peace. I enjoy the spiritual writers. St. John of the Cross tells us, where there is no love, put love, and you will find love. So oftentimes, the Lord will call us to be salt, light, and leaven. That means he puts us in places of darkness or staleness or flatness. And oftentimes, it's because we have that peace that we can be that instrument of love and mercy and peace to our loved ones. So I don't want anyone to think, well, because my family doesn't have peace or that hasn't flowed into their lives, then have I done something wrong or is the promise lacking that has been given by the Lord? And I want to give assurance that nothing is lacking in the promise of our Lord. And oftentimes we can do things as well as any fallen human being can do. And that doesn't mean that that peace will flow into the lives of our loved ones.
Anonymous, I hope that's helpful to you. I'm going to leave it there just because the lines are quite full now all of a sudden, and there are lots of people who would like to talk about peace. That's what we're talking about right now, Living in Peace, with the author of the book Living in Peace, Father Jeffrey Kirby. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. Another anonymous caller on the line. Anonymous, are you there with us?
Yes.
Hello. Oh, you sound like you might be involved in some youth. Are you a young caller?
Yes.
How old are you?
11.
11. We're so happy to have your call. Thank you for picking up the phone and calling. Go ahead and ask Father Kirby your question.
We have a large family, and we fight a lot, so I was wondering, how can we gain peace?
Oh, God bless you.
That's great. So, first, I want to start with something that might surprise you, that sometimes fighting is not necessarily a bad thing. So oftentimes, if you know there are arguments or fights in families, it could be that things are being worked out. So sometimes that could actually be a healthy thing, that we see that families are trying to work things out, and if sometimes voices are raised or people get upset, that's not a bad thing. And it doesn't mean that peace has been lost, right? Because, peace doesn't mean that everything is always smooth or quiet or passive. Peace means that we have, a proper disposition of heart, right? So we desire this right relationship. So first, I just want to acknowledge sometimes fighting isn't necessarily bad. But let's say in situations where fights can be bad or hurtful, or they go on for a really long time. Like, how do we find peace there? Well, in Acts chapter 3, we hear this great story about a beggar who asked St. Peter and St. John for gold and silver. And St. Peter responds, he says, silver and gold I do not have. He works for the church, right? He doesn't have a lot of money. So he says, silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give to you. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise and walk. Now, an important lesson from that is we cannot give what we do not have, right? So if we find that our peace is lacking, right, then what do we need? Well, we turn to the source of all peace. We turn to God. And a lot of times it means that if we want that peace back, it means we have to go and make a good confession. So some of the practical things we can do is go to confession, ask for that gift of peace and mercy. Sometimes, too, at home, it could be important that, when something is said, maybe there's a pause before something is responded to, right? So someone's getting upset, so why don't we wait for a little bit and talk later, and so on. So there could be some practical, approaches as well. But the big one is we can't give what we don't have. And if we've lost our peace, we've given it away, or something has distracted us, and then the way that we get that peace back, what we kind of reconnect, is by a good confession and by drawing close to God. So those are some quick answers to your question, and I hope that's helpful.
Okay, Anonymous?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're very grateful for your call. 888-318-7884 is our number, 888-318-7884. We've got a question about peace, got a question about living in peace. You'd like to talk to a priest about that. Father Jeffrey Kirby is here with us. He wrote the book Living in Peace, and you're welcome to talk with him. 888-318-7884. Let's go to Grace in St. Louis, Missouri, listening on Covenant Radio. Grace, thanks so much for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call.
Happy to.
My daughter and I used to be really close. People used to tease us that we were like twins. And when she reached approximately 16 years of age, she was diagnosed with mental illness. And then she got into drugs. And there was a rapid downhill slide. She had a child, and the living conditions were really bad. So I had to step in. I was raising my granddaughter. She got pregnant again, and I filed through the courts to try to get custody. Without going into detail, that did not turn out well. I ended up dropping the case because I was trying to get reconciliation between us. I was wanting to, I had offered to pay for family counseling.
Grace,
try to get her back on her feet.
Grace, I always want to interrupt you because I think I know where we're headed, and I want to get there so that Father can answer you before I have to go to another break. This is an awful, painful situation with your daughter, and there is no reconciliation at the moment, it sounds like. So I'm gathering you're asking, how do you find peace in that kind of situation? Is that right, Grace?
Yes. We live 10 miles apart. We haven't seen each other. We haven't run into each other in all this time. And this afternoon we ran into each other, and it was a terrible...
Oh, Grace, I'm sorry. I'm very sorry to hear that. Father, I'm just going to leave it to you, Father. Go ahead.
Yes, I think, Grace, you've done, it sounds, everything possible to both, you know, extend the olive branch of reconciliation to your daughter, to provide, you know, a safe and nurturing environment for your grandchildren. And in the midst of that right now, your daughter, either because of her mental illness or, you know, the choice of life that she's making, it sounds like she just can't see what you're trying to do. So there's a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of hurt, a lot of confusion. Unfortunately, it's probably going to take time for that that cloud of confusion to dissipate, to fade away. In the interim, in order for you to keep your peace, I would recommend that you just, again, draw closer to God, offer prayers of supplication for your daughter. Something that oftentimes is forgotten in our tradition, but very powerful, is fasting. You know, however, in whatever form, it could be just giving up desserts or giving up something small. It doesn't have to be extensive, but to really pray and fast for the conversion of your daughter. And as you do that, emotionally as best you can, to redirect your emotional energy to the well-being of your grandchildren and to your own health. You know, oftentimes when there's this type of confusion and anxiety, you know, the person just absorbs it all. And then what happens is they can cause great harm to themselves. They end up responding to other loved ones in ways that they, you know, are not happy with, ways that certainly God does not ask us to. So for yourself, Grace, I would say that, you know, give your daughter to the Lord as best you can, pray and fast for her, and redirect your attention to the task at hand, to the important task of helping with your grandchildren. I know how difficult that is, but I would encourage you with that in order to preserve and keep your own sense of peace.
Grace, thank you. I do hope that was helpful. We're talking about living in peace with Father Jeffrey Kirby, who wrote the book Living in Peace. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884 and talk with Father Kirby. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
He was a Jesuit, a cardinal, and a doctor of the church.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
St. Robert Bellarmine is honored for his immense contributions to theology, including helping to draft two important catechisms that defended church teachings during the Protestant Revolt. Pope Clement VIII named Bellarmine a cardinal because, as the Pope put it, Bellarmine had not his equal for learning.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Hey, in addition to this show that we're doing today for our Friday afternoon, where John Cutterback will be here next hour, philosopher John Cutterback will be here to talk about living the good life. In this hour, we have, as you can hear, a very, very fine guest, Father Jeffrey Kirby, here to talk to us about living in peace. In addition to doing that, we know it's tough times, and we thought maybe people would like to get back to the basics. We're doing a lot of things to help people get back to the basics after a very tough year, one in which many people were cut off in profound ways from the sacraments. So right now, we're giving away free one of the most popular books that's ever been published by Catholic Answers, Why We're Catholic. There's over 200,000 copies in print. We're not giving away the print edition for free, but you can have an ebook version of it. Just go to shop.catholic.com and get your free copy, ebook copy of Why We're Catholic. Maybe get some reading in and recenter. Find a reconnection to that Catholic faith that for many of us, and I got to say I'm one of them, I really miss normal parish life and all that. I miss it not just like, oh, I miss that, but miss it like I feel it in my spiritual life. And so have needed many helps, and we'd like to put some helps out there for you. Our number is 888-318-7884. As I said, our guest is Father Jeffrey Kirby, and we're talking about peace. If you're struggling with peace in your life, if there's someone you would like to help to find peace, or if you would like to talk with us about the general Christian understanding of peace, what do we mean by the peace that Christ offers and living in that peace, you're welcome to call, whether you're Christian or not, whether you're Catholic or not, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Up next on the line is Catherine in Houston, Texas, listening on 1430 AM there in Houston. Catherine, delighted to have you. Go ahead with your question for Father Jeffrey Kirby.
Well, I'm going to preface the question with a moment of peace because I am tickled that the Holy Spirit has given me a chance to say thank you, and then I'll follow that with the question. Just yesterday, I received a text from a friend, and the text just had a YouTube address, so I clicked on it and opened it, and it was a homily from a priest. And it was a homily that invoked Becket and St. Thomas More, and it was very forthright, and come to find out, this wonderful priest was Father Kirby.
And I'm glad.
He was not political. Yes, he was not political, but he was strident, and he was outspoken, and he was very clear, and he taught, and he shepherded, and he warned about, you know, the coming things that could happen in our future, and religious freedom, and our need to stay close to the sacraments, and our need to recognize our own roles as Catholics and citizens and everything else. And it gave me such peace.
Oh, what a wonderful testament to a great priest, Father Kirby. Good for you. I'm so glad it was Father Kirby, because what if it was some crazy priest that we don't talk about on the air? I'm so glad that it was you, Father Kirby. Catherine, that's really nice.
God bless you, Catherine.
I have two of his books. I have two of his books on my bookshelf. And
now you're going to read
them. One of them is Living in Beatitude. I already have. So I was delighted to know. But my question is, how can we encourage our own parish priests to feel the conviction to be able to just speak clearly, teach clearly, and stand with us and encourage people?
Yes, that's a great question, Catherine. And I think that one thing I'd like to start with that is you know, one area that a lot of parishioners, you know, may not be aware of or not fully understand is, you know, how much really are on the plates of priests right now. I was very surprised when I became a parish priest to realize that not only did I have the care of the sacraments and preaching the Word of God, but it was basically running my own small business. So things with operations or human resources or fiscal management, things I'd never been trained on, you know, and didn't fully understand it. So, of course, trying to find the right advisors among the parishioners who are skilled in these areas and yet have a theological worldview and so on. And I just mention those things because sometimes parishioners don't realize how much is really on the mind and the heart of the priest. I hope spiritual, many spiritual things, But there are also some just really practical things, like septic tanks broken, the toilets overflowing, the, you know, the landscapers quit and we have to find someone to mow the grass. And I mean, it's just, wow. You know what I mean? Like, I'm convinced that, you know, God is so structured the priesthood in such a way in order to remind the priest that he is never enough. And it causes a certain humility in the life of the priest, right? Now, with that said, I hope that the best way you could probably help your priest is by encouragement, affirmation, and strong prayer. You know, we see throughout the New Testament the call to pray for our shepherds. I pray for my bishop, not simply the Mass, but throughout the day, like when I pray the Liturgy of the Hours. Like, you know, I don't agree with everything, but I realize he's the bishop. He must know better than I do. And so I try to pray for him and offer support and encouragement, you know, and so on. I think that parishioners to their pastors, that's the greatest grace you can give them, you know, because trust me, they're getting a lot of, you're not doing it right. Who are you? You're stupid. You don't know what you're doing. People have gotten in the habit of telling priests that they're terrible priests, which that's like telling a mother she's a terrible mother. Like, that's terrible. How can you say that? Right? It's just demoralizing, right? So, Catherine, I would say just realize how much attack, spiritual and earthly, your priest is going through. And I would say affirmation, kindness. And then by establishing that relationship of affirmation, kindness, you know, then saying, you know, Father, how can we help? Or, you know, sending resources or things that might help him. Big picture, just realize how much is going on. And then I would say don't let your first cold email or, you know, out of the blue email be, why aren't you doing this right? You know?
Yeah.
I would say develop a spiritual friendship and intercession for him, and then affirm all the things he's doing right. You know, Father, I'm so glad that you're doing this or you've done that. Or, and then as the, you know, the rapport is established, and say, you know, Father, can I suggest, or have you seen this resource? I think if you do that, you will find an open heart. Priests, you know, the vast majority of men become priests because, you know, of course, they respond to a call and because they do want to help people to know and to encounter the living God. So I hope that helps a little bit, Catherine.
Oh, amen. That's wonderful. Thank you.
Well, thank you for such high praise for Father Kirby, too, to start off. That's a beautiful example of what Father Kirby said to do. I just love it. Thank you very much. Our number is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Father Kirby has a new book that's coming out. If you'd like to get it, you're going to have to wait maybe a month before the pre-orders will start, but you can look for it at shop.catholic.com. It's called Real Religion. It's from Catholic Answers Press. It should be out and ready to go before we change the clocks, I think. So do look for it. We're talking about living in peace, and he also has a book called Living in Peace. As I said, you're welcome to call if you have questions about living in peace, 888-318-7884. I was contemplating your book, Living in Peace, Father, and some of the things you say in there. And I want to ask you this, if you could say something about how much our peace is disturbed when we live kind of completely within the circle of this world, and we forget that our life is not ultimately here in this, you know, we had to open up our horizon to the eternal. That's where we belong. And that's where, you know, the fullness of peace and everything else will be.
Absolutely. In fact, this is what happens. The spiritual masters have actually traced this for us that, you know, when we live only in this world, and we have no supernatural perspective, no theological worldview, then what happens, we could say more broadly, a life of prayer. Like, if we don't have any of that, then what happens is the disappointments of this world will lead to desolation, and then the desolation will lead to despair, where eventually we think nothing matters, nothing has purpose, why even try, right? And that's what happens when we try to live a life that is completely without God or the help of His grace.
Again, 888-318-7884. I suppose that might go for societies as well as for individuals.
Amen. And we've seen it historically. Yes.
It's just such a disturbing time, and I don't know. We live in this era of so many gifts, you know, like you have so much material and scientific and technological good all around you, and we just seem not to be able to be good in it.
Yes, yes. You know, the interesting side, right now in my parish, I'm doing a Bible study on Genesis, and you look at the early line of Cain, you know, so after the expulsion from the garden, and all of the technological blessings are on the line of Cain. I mean, like, God just pours out all these blessings, you know, this discovery of tools and ironwork and so on, all these things. And yet it's from the line of Cain that we have massive depravity and evil. And you would think that, you know, God gives these blessings in order to just show us and remind us how much he cares for us so that we would draw closer to him.
Right.
So I think if we're not careful, if we don't keep the right perspective, what's meant to be blessings and helps actually become curses and oftentimes self-curses.
Again, 888-318-7884. The number up next is Paula in Minot, North Dakota. Well, did I pronounce that correctly, Paula?
Minot, North Dakota.
Oh, come on now. I should have known that. I've heard that pronounced so many times, and I just, now my peace is disturbed for the rest of my weekend. But, all right, go ahead, Paula, with your question.
I would just like to make a comment or a recommendation to Catherine, the previous caller, to look into the Seven Sisters Apostolate group for praying for peace and for your priest. And again, their mission is committed to prayerful support toward a parish pastor through the assurance of offering at least one holy hour every day of any given week for the pastor alone. They call it a holy wasting, as it were, for the conversion and holiness of that particular priest. I just read it from the book. I only joined about 4 months ago, but I just do find peace and want to spend more and more time in church and quiet prayer throughout the week. And my 1 hour on Fridays is for the Seven Sisters Apostolate. And then I go back in the week for other needs that I have.
You know, Paul, if I can say, first of all, thank you for recommending that or more broadly, any program or devotion that prays for priests, first and foremost for the spiritual health of the Catholic priesthood. But also we know that the priests in the parish, the spiritual masters, again, observe this, that if the priest is at 100%, the faithful are at 80. If he's at 80, the faithful are at 60. And it goes on and on. So in order for the priest to really be the shining example that he's called and has the grace to be, and for the people to be at 100%, the priest has to be at 120%, right? You know, like,
right.
And that's something that by our fallen nature we can't do. That's the grace of the sacrament, and that the fanning of that grace in the flame depends on the prayers and the fasting and the sacrifices of the people of God for their priests. So I thank you very much for recommending that.
Yes, and again, it's called the Seven Sisters Apostolate.
Kind of started in the Midwest, and it's spreading from there. Is that right, Paula?
Yes, correct.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny. This is another thing about living too much within the circle of this world and not the next. I think we always want some kind of program or process or something, and I don't know. I suppose, Father, we don't put enough faith in the basic things that Christ gave us, like you said, praying and fasting.
Amen. Amen. When we realize that everything we need has been given to us, and we've been even blessed with the time in order to unpackage and integrate and use what the Lord has given to us, there's a profound sense of gratitude and humility, as well as confidence. Like, we have everything we need, right? To live this way of life, to have the peace and hold that peace that he gives us. We have everything that we need. He has given us all that we need.
My problem with fasting is I just get so hungry, but I would do it. Otherwise, I would do it a lot more. Father Jeffrey Kirby, may we have your blessing before we go?
Absolutely. Let's pray. Father, I ask your blessing upon your servants. May you always open their ears and their hearts to your word, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Father Jeffrey Kirby has been our guest. You can find the book Living in Peace wherever good Catholic books are sold. And very soon here at Catholic Answers, the brand new book will come out called Real Religion. Again, Father Jeffrey Kirby, it's always such a pleasure to get to talk with you. Thank you for doing this hour with us.
Likewise, Si. Thank you.
Peace be with you, Father.
Thank you.
Coming up next, John Cuddeback, philosopher John Cuddeback, and we're going to talk about living the good life. As a matter of fact, crafting a good life, how to craft a life the way God, the carpenter, Jesus would craft a life. We'll do that right after this. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. And we can still say Happy New Year. We're still at the very beginning of the year. Maybe you're just getting back to us after all of your end of year and beginning of year festivities or whatever you were involved in or up to, and we're happy to have you here with us. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and these are a little bit crazy times we're living in, actually. Maybe you think I'm going out on a limb saying that, but these seem like a little bit crazy times. Many people are upset. Lots of people are wondering about what's going to happen next. And our feeling here at Catholic Answers is that at times like these, get back to basics. Not out on a limb, but right back to basics. And that's what we're doing this hour. It's what we did last hour. I'm going to try to answer some very basic questions this hour. How do you live a good life? What constitutes a good life? How were we made to live? What kinds of things can we do to live as God made us to live? And also we'll be asking about, is it worth doing those things at a time like this? Are they worthwhile doing those things at a time like this? Our guest is Professor John Cutteback. He's a professor of philosophy at Christendom College, and he's the founder and proprietor of one of those gems of the internet. It's the Lifecraft website. And you can find it at life-craft.org, life-craft.org. If you are one of those people who wants to live a well-ordered life, I highly recommend you visit Lifecraft. Really do visit it. And also sign up, and you'll receive Dr. Cutteback's Wednesday quotes and reflections. I receive them, and I'm always happy I do. Maybe that's not a good advertisement. Maybe people are like, "Mom, if somebody who showed some evidence of living an orderly life were to say they get them, that would they help me, and they'll help you." You're also welcome to take. He's got two free online courses there: Man of the Household and Woman of the Household. Right now, we'll talk with him about living that good life in these difficult times. Dr. John Cutteback, thank you for being with us.
Cy, it's great to be with you. Can you hear me okay, Cy?
You sound great. Yeah, I can hear you fine. Thank you.
Super. Good.
Okay, so Lifecraft, it's about crafting the kind of life that we were meant to have. There's something about it that it's not just an assertion, so to speak, but it also, to me, feels like a response, that there's something about this world that's pushing us away from having the light. And you're trying to draw people back to a kind of more ancient wisdom.
Yeah, I that's a good way of putting it. To kind of expand on that, I'd say I see myself as trying to amplify a voice that's already there in future. You know, I mean, in so many ways, the culture that we're in, the society that we're in, is working against nature, is working against the gifts of a natural order that comes to us, of course, ultimately from God. And one of the exciting things to me is to be able to be saying to people, look, this is not my idea. This is a wisdom that's ancient because great men have seen this from long ago, if they're willing to be humble and attentive to what God is saying to us.
Our number, if you'd like to get involved in this conversation, and you're welcome to get involved in this conversation, but I always feel when we have Dr. Cutteback here that I just want to talk to him. And so I'm going to do that. I will take up all the time just talking to him, asking him questions, having a great conversation. And but you're willing to get involved in this conversation, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. So this idea of drawing on this ancient wisdom, drawing on what's already there, it seems to me that all the signs suggest that as a society, we're doing less and less of that, actually, not more and more of it. When we need it, we're actually doing less and less of it.
Right. I think that's absolutely the case. And sometimes, perhaps for some, that's intentional. I think that for many, it's not intentional. It's a mistake. But we find ourselves being drawn along with currents that are very bad. And there's so many aspects of the contexts, Cy, in which we find ourselves that take us away from the natural order. And one of the things I'd really love to emphasize here is the simple aspects of it. I mean, even setting aside, first of all, the higher supernatural aspects, which are a furthering of that gift, but just for instance, the aspects of relationship in that amazing natural community called the family and household, and the kind of life that's shared there daily, This is something that's of nature. And more the currents, the customs of our society are setting that aside. People aren't even together.
Yeah.
Right? The kinds of things that are so central to living a fundamentally human life, we're missing. They're either being taken away from us or often very subtly. And so more and more our life is kind of getting stripped and bare. It tends to leave us alone and disconnected. A big aspect of it is we're getting disconnected. We're getting disconnected from one another. We're getting disconnected from nature and the earth. We're getting disconnected from God.
Again, 888-318-7884, our number, 888-318-7884. That didn't get better this year. This sense of being disconnected did not. This was a disaster year as far as that goes.
Yeah, it is. I mean, there's so many sad aspects, and I think perhaps what we should do is focus. And so I'm going to throw something out at you here, Si.
Okay.
One of the great, I think, frustrations that people are having is probably a bit of frustration in the political area, and just having the sense of so many bad things, or at least questionable things, are happening in the broader society. You have this sense of kind of helplessness. What can I be doing about this? And I'd like to throw something out here. I'm going to go to Aristotle. Aristotle has a profound, very wise understanding of a natural order where God intended for us kind of levels of community. We should be part of a broader society where there should be authority that does certain things for us to bring about a broader order in our community. But the reality is sometimes that doesn't happen. And if that's missing, Aristotle actually is very specific. He says, well, okay, and sometimes, of course, that's going to be the case. And so what do you turn to then? You go to the kind of the next lower down level of kind of what is reasonably in your control. And I think something that should give us a kind of sense of, may I say, empowerment, is it's in our control. It's within our power to turn to these very basic things, such as this right now. Let's talk about household for a moment, or friendships, relationships that we can work on, regardless of what's going on more broadly in the society, no matter what the kind of broad failures of others are in the culture and proper authority, law enforcement, in the church. So many ways we can feel that we're being failed. And we are. Okay, well, rather than complaining about that, let's look at what's in our control. And we can still set out to do so much in these other more proximate relationships to kind of restore and bring out the human.
It's funny because as you say that, I feel like part of what we're told constantly is if you're not part of some great movement, if you're not marching somewhere, I mean, everybody on every side is marching, rioting, throwing things. This is a measure of your, even in trying to control the future of the weather, if you're not all in on these things, this is a mark of your lack of moral seriousness. But you're saying just the opposite, that moral seriousness is not about these big movements.
Well, let's put this way. First, it's always maintaining a balance. Some people, when they hear when I'm making this point, it can sound to them as though I'm saying, hey, just abandon the broader community, abandon the realm of the political.
Right.
I'm not saying. Sometimes it might be appropriate, to be really playing your part and standing up and making your voice heard in that broader movement. But I don't think that's probably going to be, especially for most of us, where most of our focus is going to be right now. And so, ready for that, as we might be called to do, let's just roll up our sleeves and focus on the things, again, that are in our power. And that tends to be the things that are more proximate. If you're a father in a household, if you're a mother in a household, for instance, we can say that's something the others too, but a lot of our audience are probably that. There's so much that can be done. And I'm not claiming that you're unaffected. You're going to be affected, but it still is very much in your control. How you, as for you and your house, what are you going to do? How are you going to respond to this? There is a path of integrity, even if it's a painful and a difficult one to discern. There is a path of integrity right now of continuing to put order, right? I know, Sai, you love this theme of kind of putting order into things. The great call and vocation, all of us according in various states in life, to be putting order into, first of all, our own life, and then being generous towards others, putting order into their lives through, say, our friendships with them or in that household community. The sky's the limit. And when we do that, we are serving the broader community. That's key. We're not abandoning the broader community. We're certainly not abandoning the church. This is how we serve those broader communities, by being faithful daily right there. This is very exciting.
888-318-7884, the number. We're talking about putting things in order. We're talking about living that well-ordered and good life that God has called us to with philosopher Dr. John Cuddeback from Christendom College, also the proprietor of Lifecraft. You can find it at life-craft.org. I strongly suggest you do. It's a great, great reminder of that, you know, that there are things that are within our control, and we can make our corner of the world quite something special, actually, and quite something beautiful if we will follow those who have gone before us and done just that. We have to take a break. There are folks on the line. I'm going to get to you when we come back. There are lines open as well. 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. Right back with John Cuddeback right after this.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage Program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
This is what St. Teresa of Calcutta, also known as Mother Teresa, once said about prayer. Love to pray. Feel often during the day the need for prayer and take trouble to pray. Prayer enlarges the heart until it is capable of containing God's gift of Himself. Ask and seek, and your heart will grow big enough to receive Him and keep Him as your own. That is why we need prayer.
Aren't faith and reason two separate and distinct kinds of truth? Why do Christians believe in the biblical creation story when science has disproved it? How can the modern world take religion seriously when they oppose scientific advancements like birth control and stem cell research? In 20 Answers, Faith and Science, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more, clearing away misconceptions and helping you to understand and explain to your friends and family the complex but ultimately harmonious relationship between religious and scientific truth. 20 Answers, Faith and Science is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Our apostolate here at Catholic Answers is about explaining and defending the Catholic faith. That's what we do. We explain and defend the Catholic faith, but we don't do it just because it makes us feel better to do it. It's because there is a life that is offered in the person of Jesus Christ and in His church that is a life worth living, and there are very few people in the world today helping it with that. Discovering that life and discovering it from a philosopher's perspective and helping people to find what's in our nature as human beings to do, and also to find the supernatural, which is a part of our nature as human beings, is to seek the supernatural and to live well-ordered and peaceful and properly kind of centered and grounded lives in a world that really is, in many ways, just constantly trying to knock you off your horse, just constantly trying to knock you off whatever peace you've found or whatever conclusion you've come to or whatever hope you have been able to muster. The world is constantly in attack mode against those things. A person who will be a great help to you, you can find a lot of his work at Lifecraft online. You just go to life-craft.com. Kataback.org, and you can find the work of Dr. John Kataback. Sign up, get the Wednesday emails, get the you can take the courses on that he's got. He's got a new course on being a kind of a man of the household, and a new, and then the newest one is woman of the household. Thinking about the household as the place where real life actually really happens, and how to make that real life. The real life that it that you've been made for. That's what John Kataback does. He's also got a brand new book coming out. I think it'll come out. The new book comes out, True Friendship, comes out next week from Ignatius Press.
Yeah. Yes, it does. Yeah.
So yeah. All these things that just hearing these words, frankly, they make me feel better about things like friendship and household and even basic words like man and woman. They make you feel better. Why? What is it, even just hearing the words and being called back to those things, that makes you feel better?
You know, Shai, I think it's because it resonates so deeply with us. It resonates with something deep within us, the gift of human nature. And, you know, as you just mentioned, our Lord said he came that we might have life and have it more fully. And this begins in the most simple, natural things. I mean, a flourishing household. There's nothing like it. It's just such a powerful reality in its fullness, right? And so this is where I think it's very important for us that one and the same time that we're focusing on growing in our faith and growing in the supernatural life, to see the way that the supernatural life is deeply interwoven with things that are so natural. I heard a very wise person say, one of the reasons so many people find it hard to live the supernatural life to which Christ called us is, especially today, the way that the natural human life is being undermined. Let me just be specific for a moment. Things as simple as sitting around a dinner table together, sitting in the family room, sitting in the living room, sitting around a fireplace, reading out loud together. I am such a proponent of reading out loud, telling stories, being together. This connects us. This brings us alive in such profound ways. These things must not be underestimated, especially the young hardly ever see this kind of thing. They don't know what relationship and community can look like.
Oh, that is just so helpful, because that's exactly, you're calling people into community, and often we're doing it in words, who maybe have never experienced real community in their whole life.
Amen. And that's why this is to evangelize. To be pointing out to people that just restoring what one author I like calls the ordinary functions of human life.
Yeah.
The kinds of things that, especially through the problem of technology, tends to be taken away from us. The face-to-face contact, the sharing of a certain silence and bodily presence as incarnate spirits. The bodily presence is so important. Again, these things not to be underestimated, not to be shunned as though this isn't important. No, in the name of spirituality and the higher good, we honor and cultivate the very simple natural things, the way of being together bodily. So these are things that we should set in our sights and say, hey, it's not going to be super easy, but it is very much within our power to start doing these habits. If we're married and have the household, start living together in a more intentional, intense way, daily, gathering for simple things. And if it's not a family, if it's other, if we're living with other young folk or if we're older people, I mean, opening our home, hospitality, the incredible art of hospitality, all these things are interwoven. This is the root of Christianity.
Amen. John Kataback is our guest. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. First up is Mary in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Mary, thank you so much for your call. Go ahead with your comment or question for Dr. John Kataback.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm really enjoying this. I would consider it conversation because it is so needed. I mean, you guys are so right. the powers of the world are just dissecting everything from us. And yeah, last year was bad, especially in my area too, because we also had derecho come through, and which made it even more difficult. People are still trying to build back their lives. So much damage in this area. But at the same time, the Lord is using that as an opportunity to awaken people and to bring them together and to help each other. But I really appreciate your words, because they will give me tools in which to talk to people. I mean, I think I've lived in a different time set, in a sense, versus my peers, where I had a very clear understanding as a little girl of family. But most people nowadays don't have that. And so this gives me a way to utilize the words that you're saying to come back into a fullness of how to tell other people, hey, I know where you are, but we need to move forward. And you know, just having the words to say, because it's so easy to get discouraged.
I think that that's a high compliment for a philosopher. That's what a philosopher does, is give us the words to say those things we know we need to, but we can't think of them.
That was said beautifully, actually. And I'm moved, and I'm honored. I'm encouraged. That's exactly what I'd like to try to do myself and help people do. And I think, was it Mary, that you're seeing that we need now, we're called now to reach out to people in very basic ways. And it's absolutely a form of evangelizing, just to be, whether it's smiling, having a real conversation, welcoming them into our home, encouraging them, being present to them and listening. Again, these things must not be underestimated. They are so powerful. They're so human. And if they're human, this is a gift from God to us. And this is the foundation for exactly the kind of relationship he wants to have with us. This is where we develop the habits of this kind of living, the kind of living he wants to share with us, but right here in these simple ways.
Thank you, Mary. Appreciate that call. Was there anything else you wanted to share with us, or does that do it?
I just want to say that emphasizes reflecting on Christmas and realizing that Jesus became so humble and in the ordinariness of our lives, and makes it profound and powerful. And
Amen.
People need to kind of remember that so we can get back on track.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you very, very much. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. I'm going to go to another caller, but I want to come back to a thought that's occurring to me too, is that I think when many people hear about this kind of building of the household, constructing the household, there's a lot of obstacles to overcome to get from here to there, from where I am living now and the way that I and my family are living, to get to there. So I do want to just kind of tee that up for the listener. I'm going to ask Dr. Cutterback about that in a little bit. Let's go. But I don't want to leave Carl in Hawaii waiting. I call all the way from Hawaii. I don't want to miss his call. So, Carl, are you there, and are you on the Big Island? Hi, Carl. Oh, I did not hang up on him. It was not me. Oh, they're all looking at me, John. Oh, I asked him if he's on the Big Island. He's probably like on Maui or something. He's like, I don't even want to talk to this guy. He thinks I'm on. But the reason I asked him if he's on the Big Island is that's the only one that has a station that carries us. So I just assumed. But maybe Carl will call back. Sorry, John, just getting rid of your callers for you.
That's all right. Maybe we'll get him back.
So let me just ask you that question that I said I was going to ask you then, about getting from here to there, that life is so hectic and the habits are ingrained. How do I get to where the household feels like a household?
Start small. I think the key is we have to be very practical. We can't try to fix it all at one time. You could start to think in terms of, wow, I'd like my household to look like this. If you try to do the whole ball of wax at one time, it's going to be very discouraging. So let's start small with just couple examples. I mean, is it meals? Let's focus on our meals together. Again, this is whether it's a family or it's several recent college graduates, whatever it is, an older retired couple. Be very intentional about having meals together regularly. If it's not three times a day, make sure that it is the one time a day. Are we turning off the technology? Are we focusing on listening to one another? Like, this is a huge thing to do and accomplish. Start with that.
All right. I'm going to get with, just because I heard the music, I got to take a quick break. We'll come right back. As a matter of fact, you have a CD that comes from us about that. We'll talk about that when we get back with Dr. John Cutabat.
Catholic Answers Live.
If you spend any time on Twitter, Facebook, or mainstream media, you're probably familiar with the litany of slogans that skeptics employ to rescue you from the foolish belief that God exists. The constant onslaught seems to leave people with the idea that they have no alternative but to embrace atheism. How can a Christian respond? In One Less God Than You, John DeRosa breaks down 20 of the most common atheist challenges and shows you how to craft effective answers. Atheism is more aggressive and widespread than ever. Read One Less God Than You and prepare yourself to respond with the joyful truth that God is real. To get your copy of One Less God Than You, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
To many people, purgatory is a fantasy, or worse, a wicked lie invented by the Church. But I'm here to tell you that purgatory is fact, not fiction. In my new book, Purgatory is for Real, I'll give you the evidence and reasoning to help you understand this controversial doctrine and demonstrate how it's actually a sign of God's love and mercy. To get your copy of Purgatory is for Real, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Have you subscribed to the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter? This is Catholic Answers Live host Cy Kellett, and I want to tell you about our new weekly newsletter full of behind-the-scenes information and facts you need to know about the show. It's easy to sign up. Just visit CatholicAnswersLive.com and look for the newsletter sign-up box on the front of the page. It's a great way to keep up to date with what's happening with the show and see what's coming in the days ahead, delivered weekly into your inbox. Sign up today for the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter and see what you've been missing. Go to CatholicAnswersLive.com. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I just love talking with our guest this hour, Dr. John Cutabat. He's a philosopher at Christendom College. Well, he's a philosopher wherever he goes, not just when he's at Christendom College. Wherever he goes, he's a philosopher, but he works there at Christendom College. And he has a website you should visit, Lifecraft. It's about crafting a life, a full life, and drawing on the long, long wisdom of the philosophers and others in crafting such a life. It's life-craft.org. That's where you go, life-craft.org. Something that I appreciate so much is this focus on the natural that you have, that there's some way that, for A, we're very removed from nature in the modern world, in our modern lives, and B, the things that are natural to human beings are often denigrated in the modern world. It's things like marriage and family and children and all of that. And so if we're struggling so much on the natural side, it's very hard to connect with all the supernatural gifts that God wants to give us. I wonder if you see something positive or negative in all of the home shows on TV. Do you know what I'm talking about? Where everybody's watching these shows about how to make the home nice in a way.
Sorry, buddy, you're spot on. It's funny. My wife was just saying that to me. We're talking, Sophie and I talk all the time about household. And how to try to live it better, how to share with others the things we're thinking about. And she was just pointing out to me, there's clearly something of nature at work in the fact that people are just having the sense they want to go back to basic stuff. But here's the thing, for many, the only thing that they kind of immediately have a sense of where they could put their energy is in the externals. is in kind of fixing stuff up, making it look more beautiful, which I'm all about. That should be a beautiful part of crafting the good life in the home. But what we've lost is the real heart of it, because of course our culture has so given up on the deeper human goods, which need to be crafted and arranged in the household. And this is the incredible dignity of what a husband and a wife are called to do together in their home. This is why I like to use the crafting the good life in this rich, deep, fulsome way in their household, where the material stuff and the decorations have importance, but they have importance in view of how they serve and are ordered to the deeper things, the personal connections, the spiritual goods, the friendship, the virtues, the contemplative aspect. This all has to be crafted together. So I want to try to tap into people's sense of, hey, we need to be doing more in our homes. We sure do. And we need to be doing in our homes a lot more than just getting the Joanna Gaines look. I'm not in any way saying, so I'm all for, the Joanna Gaines, kind of attentiveness to things there, all about it. But then let's bring that up into the deeper things.
Amen.
Connect to the higher things.
Right. It doesn't end with the shiplap. The shiplap is there for a higher reason. Who's ever watched Joanna Gaines knows what I'm talking about. 888-318-7884, our number. Let's go to Julie in Bluffton, South Carolina, watching on YouTube Live. Julie, thank you so much for your call. Go ahead with your question for Dr. John Cuddeback.
Hi. Well, I told the call screener that it really wasn't a question, but it's definitely something wonderful about Dr. Cuddeback, because, and you too, Cy, because before I was not watching this, and I found you, and I thought your sense of humor was awesome, so I really enjoy watching you even just for that. But I was tuning in tonight just by accident, and I see Dr. Cuddeback. And I'm so excited because Dr. Cuddeback, I've been your student at ICC. And I moved out of the state. I moved out of the, yeah, well, I'm telling you, that was the one of the most wonderful courses I've taken from you at the ICC. I can't even tell you. I lived in Northern Virginia for 50 years, and then I moved to South Carolina 5 years ago. And this is a real different ball game here, I got to tell you. But I'm really excited to see you online and actually looking at you. And, you know, we're a lot older. Both of us are. You were much, much, much younger when you were teaching me. But you look terrific. And I just remember all the good stuff I learned from you. So thank you.
Well, that's so kind of you. And it's such a blessing to me to have the opportunity to teach things that endure. Things that never change, that are the things that we think about now and that we'll think about and thank God for everlasting ages. But thank you very much.
Well, you're awesome. And so are you, Cy. And also, another funny thing was that I just heard Father Kirby, or was it Father Kirby?
Kirby,
that's
yeah.
What his name is.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I just heard him, and it's funny because I listen to all these people, and I just found him like in the last couple of months, and he's here in my own diocese in Charleston, and I didn't even know it.
So, Julie, it's a conspiracy to make you happy. That's what's going on here, is a vast conspiracy to make you happy and to fill your life with joy. And most of the people involved in it are people you can't even see. They're angels. Julie, you are too. Thanks so much. I really appreciate that call. Our number is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. We're talking about, well, yeah, well, in part, this conversation, to me, I am just so happy to be able to have it today, because I do think in recent months, recent weeks, and I suppose if you have been paying attention in recent decades, there's a growing sense of upset, isolation, and what upset and isolation breed, lots of anger and resentment towards one another and all of these things. And I think we can probably look for easy solutions, quick solutions. Certainly politics is one of those places where we think if we could just get this one or that one, then that will solve the problem for us. I don't think that that's true. I'm not at all saying that politics is unimportant. But I do think Dr. John Cuddeback, who is our guest this hour, has his finger on those things that are most important, that do actually restore the things that we want restored and bring back to life those things that have withered in our culture. Things like reading aloud. Isn't that a wonderful thing, reading aloud? It's amazing to me that you, I mean, I'm so happy that you would say something like that, because what we often find, you know, we're getting a question about transubstantiation or a question about how are we justified and saved and that kind of thing. But there's also this other side to the good life, which is paying attention to how we're living moment by moment and sharing that life with other people.
Amen. Amen. I mean, just that we choose a few of those things. Again, it's a very practical approach of thinking about, again, something in our power, something that by the grace of God we can be working on with those that we love the most. How can we be building up that human life, which absolutely is a gift from God? His plan interweaves the natural and the supernatural. God himself never looks down on the natural. It is his plan. And so the kind of, it's just part of the plan. So those more natural, simple parts of the plan are absolutely essential to the supernatural being what it is. And so that the habits of presence and being together, well, this is what the Eucharist is about. I mean, you're right. I mean, sure, then we can talk about the it's very important, those questions of the technicalities and theology of how we give an account for those things. But at the end of the day, what's the Eucharist about? It's about the presence of persons.
Wow.
Our Lord wants to be with us. And he wants to be with us.
Right.
And we just naturally have to have a sense and ability to be present if we're going to be with him in the Eucharist.
888-318-7884 is the number. As you were speaking, I was thinking about the great, one of the greatest saints in all of history, Philip Neri. And one of the ways that he lived as an apostle, he's considered the new apostle to Rome and all that. He invited people to go on picnics. That was his big evangelical.
Yeah,
let's go on a picnic together. Yeah. You know, he'd take a whole group of people on a picnic.
And I'm sure they had a great time. And, you know, in part, Si, there's this great principle. The higher the realities that you share, the more bounds together you are. So I say it because it struck me. You mentioned earlier, again, it's that isolation, it's that being alone. There's so much the problem now. We need to be reconnected. Well, it's the higher goods. It's the spiritual goods that most bring us together, that most connect us. And so that we're doing that in simple ways in our home. We're turning to those higher things. You don't need a lot of money. You certainly don't need much technology. In fact, often it's better without it. Right, to be able to turn to those higher things, and particularly as Catholics, you have the great gift of those spiritual goods that we enter into together, we can discuss, that we contemplate together. This is to be alive, this is to be bright, and this is to be united with one another in our being united with God.
We have to take a quick break. That'll give you time to dial and get involved in this conversation. Philosopher John Cuddeback is our guest. 888-318-7884 is our number. Don't forget, he's got a brand new book coming out from Ignatius Press next week on true friendship. This is one of those natural things which with so many supernatural connections. You can look forward to that book next week at Ignatius Press. True Friendship from John Cuddeback. We will take a quick break. We'll be right back with more of our conversation, which you're willing to get. Oh, I should give out the number one time before we go. 888-318-7884. All right, get in on the conversation. We'll be right back.
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The wisdom of Mother Angelica.
Have you ever been so grief-stricken and so heart-sick that you can't see God? You can't see God in the tragedy. You can't see God in that cross. You can't see God in that sin. Why? You're enveloped in that grief. You're enveloped in fear. And God is out the window. You don't see him standing right next to you.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, 888-318-7884, our number. We're talking about with the man who talks all the time about and helps you to craft a life in a way using those tools that have been given to us by the natural, by the philosophers, and by the mystics, and by the teachers, and by the Lord himself. You're welcome to call if you have questions about that, 888-318-7884. Yesterday, I didn't even know that I was doing this. I said, we're leaving the show, and we're still on the air, and I said to Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press, hey, do you know the philosopher John Cutteback? And he doesn't add. Yes, as a matter of fact, next week he has a book coming out with us, True Friendship. So I'm glad to hear Mark's a good one. But I've done this ad again and again for his book, True Friendship, that's coming out, and I keep forgetting to mention detoxing you and your family from tech, which is a wonderful DVD that he did for us here at Catholic Answers. You can find that all over. Just put in detoxing your family from tech, or just put in John Cutteback, and you'll find it on the internet. Get that and watch that. Maybe watch it with the family and think about detoxing from tech. Why is that an important part of building the household? The main project that you have, which is building the household, why is detoxing from tech so important in that, Dr. Cutteback?
No, I'd say it's because of the ways that technology is getting in the way or handicapping us, holding us back from these basic ways of living, basic forms of living, acting, working, being together. It's not that these technologies are intrinsically evil. They are not. But we need to take a practical, hard-nosed, realistic approach. The reality is that they are holding us back. They are changing our patterns of life in a negative way, making us handicapped in being able to do things that, again, they're so simple, they're so natural, they're so human, but we don't know that we're missing them, or we feel that there's something missing. And again, I mean, something like the particularly people looking at the younger folk who tend to be more into, just to you take the example, right, they're in their phone, they're in the texting, and we see how it takes away their ability to be bodily present, to look people in the eye, to have conversations, to live in the now. I keep saying this term bodily presence because it's human presence has to be bodily presence. You need to be in the here and now. But in so many ways, these technologies, great simple example of how it's handicapping us, it makes it harder for us to be in the now. But the now is really all that exists. The now of right here. Our technologies, there's a reason that they might be useful in being able to take us to someplace or someone far away. But when that becomes habitual, then we actually have a net negative situation. So to get hard-nosed, I need to use them for certain things. Great, let's use them for certain things. Let's recognize, especially in the kind of sacred, sacrosanct place of the household, the kind of womb of human life, to be setting aside certain places and certain times so that we say, here, we're going to kind of be in our greater full humanity. So it's in the name of the human life. It's in the name of human presence, human relationship, that we recognize how we need to sometimes say no.
Again, 888-318-7884, our number. Dr. John Cutteback, our guest. So the detoxing, I suppose almost everything that we get from the Lord himself involves repent and believe, or repent and be baptized. There's always repent and then do the thing. And the repent is detaching. It has to do with detaching. Yeah. And then the other thing always has to do with attaching ourselves to him.
Amen. So well said.
So the detaching, I think sometimes there are people who would like to detach and get the family more detached from the technology. But in a certain sense, you got to have something worthwhile to replace it with.
Amen. And that's why our being intentional in our relationships in these spaces, such as our home and the workplace, to the extent that we can, is so important. I say this to parents all the time. If you're going to say no, you've got to have a yes. And here's another quickie on the technology. It itself, our addiction to it shows that we want connection and presence. Yeah. The problem that it is so that it so hooks us is because it's an easy and cheap way of having the feeling of connection, but it ends up being a charade, a chimera, a ghost. And so we're going to have, this is where the detoxing is. We've got to say no, it's going to be hard. We got to pull that out. The deeper connection takes a deeper cultivation. It takes more of an effort, but we're constantly being told, hey, technology makes everything easy. You can't take the shortcut to human relationships and presence. We have to be willing to do the deeper cultivation. It's not out of reach, but it is. It does take something more. And so it does take the no over there and then the yes. So we need to be giving them that vision of, here's what a vibrant life looks like. Here's what your vibrant relationships look like. And this is the why you need to say no over there, because this yes is what you're made for.
888-3187-884, the number. So you gave us a couple of things that you can do in the home. And I mean, imagine these are possible for, you know, like my wife and I, a married couple where almost all of our kids are out of the home. One kid not gone yet. But we'll kick him out soon. Don't worry. We will kick him out soon. But these, like the idea of sharing meals together, reading together, I can see how these are, especially for the young family where there's still children at home, these are kind of, they build the family, but they also apply to any other kind of home. I mean, I suppose if you were, you know, young singles living together. You got any more for us?
I do.
Okay.
I was hoping you'd ask. Thank you. I'm cutting you off to give you my answer. Rich, meaningful work in the home, especially work that connects us to the natural world. The Christian tradition is very strong on this. The first book by which God wants to reveal himself to us, to teach us about himself, to teach us about ourselves, is the natural world. And he has designed it that we can interact in deeply meaningful ways with the natural world. The household should be the place where we particularly make those connections. And connecting to the natural world, it's another way we connect with one another. And particularly through rich kinds of work. Is it woodworking that appreciates these incredible natural substances that God has given us? The always to remembered gardening in the most simple ways or a fully developed way. Everybody can have a garden, even if it's just on your patio, a way of tuning into the earth and the natural rhythms, the gift of a nature and a natural order and how it connects with us. There's so many things to learn about God, his loving providence, teleology, the ordering of things to an end for their good, the relationship of parts and wholes. Aristotle, St. Thomas, and there's so much to read. St. Thomas focused on natural world is God's book. We need to learn to read it. It's not easy, but interact with it. It daily, finding that, especially through good work, going for hikes and just observing is wonderful too, but then particularly working with it also in such, and this is why I always, to the extent that you can, in some little way, garden, connect with God's good earth in a meaningful way that also serves your household.
You know, this is a way in which I imagine that the technology here could be helpful too, because I was just talking with a woman not too long ago who was learning with her daughters things like making soap and working with textiles. And the main way she's learning is they're watching YouTube videos, but they're learning to do something together.
Absolutely. Use the YouTube videos, learn how to do it, and then turn off your computer and do it in your kitchen. Do it with one another. Those are excellent examples. The home arts. These are as old as man and woman. The husbandry, the beautiful arts of housewifery. These things are so life-giving. They're simple. They give young people a sense of themselves. There's a sense of art there. There's a sense of beauty. This is a big thing I love to emphasize in man of the household and woman of the household. These are the contexts to make the connections, the relationships that are so important between spouses, between parents and children. Good work, recultivating, rediscovering, not all the home arts. Again, small steps. Choose things that are with our power. I like to choose one.
Yeah.
Choose two. Don't have to go overboard. This is of God. This is of our nature.
Yeah, like, so for example, if you live in an apartment, if the family lives in an apartment, you're not going to do farming, but you could do a window box. We used to do those window boxes when I lived in the city, there's many other kind of tactile and natural things you can do for
exactly. Exactly. The arts of food, not just production, but food preparation and serving, the arts of hospitality. Where's the hospitality? No doubt that's so central to Scripture and understanding Scripture. It's so central to the Christian tradition. Think of the Benedictine tradition, that great central aspect of the monastic life that was so central to our civilization. Receiving others as receiving Christ. Think what it does. What a way of evangelizing. Treat every person that comes to your door as though he's Christ and invite him into something warm and alive. They'll notice that you're Christian. You don't have to be speaking of it. What a form of evangelization to open our homes in hospitality.
And you know, the opportunities are there. People are desperate for this kind of, I mean, imagine we've got to get by a lot of the current limitations that people have on visiting and doing that kind of thing, and we'll get there. But the opportunities are there. I mean, lots and lots of people. I even remember my kids. It's funny that just the fact that my wife and I stayed married, lots of kids wanted to visit my kids in our house. It not because we were such great yes. people or wonderful. They just liked being around a family that was intact.
Exactly. And again, see this as part of receiving the gift of God's plan for us. See it as fortifying the next generation with the basic habits that are the most important habits, both for nature and for supernature. We strengthen our communities, beginning in that community that's right there for us every day, our household. And this is the powerhouse. Dig deep here, build deep here, and that life will overflow. This is a beautiful model for evangelization. We're not turning away from others. We're intensifying our life so that it can overflow. It's very parallel to the Dominican motto, contemplate, and then share the fruits of your contemplation. Here's a great motto for households, like thrive, live deeply and humanly, and share that with others.
John Cuddeback has been our guest this hour, and I know that there are many people listening and thinking, I'd like to, and then you're going to want to be reminded. It's very easy to be reminded. You can go to Dr. Cuddeback's website, life-craft.org, and sign up for the Wednesday messages, and you won't be sorry you did. You'll get these lovely, well-crafted messages that will help you in crafting that life that you so want to craft. Also, don't forget Dr. John Cuddeback's brand new book, True Friendship, is out next week from Ignatius Press. You can get it at Ignatius Press, or you can get it anywhere good Catholic books are sold. And when you go to LifeCraft, you can take a couple of free courses. There's a couple of free courses you can do there, whether you're a man or a woman, to help you to build the household. Dr. John Cuddeback, it's always great to talk with you. Thank you so much for a fine hour.
Thank you so much, Ty. I love it, too. Really appreciate it. God bless you.
Oh, there's so much to be hopeful about. It didn't feel like it this week, but there is. And never forget, Jesus Christ is the light of the nations. We'll see you next time right here on Catholic Answers Live.